Hotep community, welcome back to another amazing episode of Shock Metaphysics, First Frequency of Oneness. I'm your illustrious host, the Metaphysical Morpheus, a.k.a. Rev Shock, a.k.a. Shook Shock, a.k.a. Uncle Phil of Philosophy. I think that's what Akil calls me. Go Travel Abroad calls me Shockalicious. Then I'm Shook Shock, Shook Shocker. It's just a lot of shock going on. And so back with us on our beautiful Thursday is Dr. Clyde Winters, our elder Ababa, who is going to just blow our minds and blow our hair back. I don't have any hair to blow back, so if you see my beard moving, that's because of Dr. Winters and what he's going to be presenting today. Welcome back, beloved Baba. How are you?
I'm fine, you know. This past week, for the last couple of weeks, a lot of people have been talking about Keisha Cole.
And what's going on with Keisha Cole?
Well, she took a DNA test, and she was very happy to announce that she was mixed race. And she said she was mixed race because of the fact that her 23andMe profile said that she had 28% European DNA. But I really am sorry to tell the young lady that 28% that they're talking about belongs to the Y chromosome R1. And it's a black. Keisha, you're still black.
We need to do
mixed race. These people wow. Don't know. They don't know. They don't know. They accept whatever the white man tell them, and they don't know that the white man
trying to matter.
That's right.
White lives are trying to matter. That's what this is.
That's right. And these black people.
Wow. I didn't know this.
These black people, they want to be something else so bad.
Yeah, they do. Third frequency.
They don't even know that the first documented slave burials that they uncovered carried R1. And see, the white man has said R1 is an identifier of white people. No. Black people took it in, and the earliest Europeans were all R1. But see, they got it from us. But see, when black people don't know their history, you can tell a fool anything. Yes.
We're gonna make you like the black Maury Povich and just have people come on and say, you are not European. You are not second frequency. You are African. That's gonna be the new Clyde Winters thing. You are not white. You are not in second frequency. You know, that's hilarious. That's hilarious.
You know, these people, they just need it. They just need to be somebody else. They got to be somebody else than what you are.
Yeah.
You're foundational black American. You know, your parents grew up here. You got ancestry. You got ancestry, but you got mixed ancestry. Mixture of a lot of different African people, black Indian
Absolutely.
People. Maybe some white people. But you know, the thing is this, that they raped a lot of our grandmothers. They raped a lot of them. But I mean, hey, it was just too many of us for them to have a real impact. Now, down in New Orleans, in New Orleans, they made it kind of such a great process of it. But the rest of the United States, yeah, they made it. But they Washington had his, and they all made it with black women. But come on now. You know, study, learn who you are. That's
absolutely
what we're here for. That's what we're here for.
That's right. That's right. That's right.
It's enough for history. Your real history.
Queen Mother Tiana Bean from Bermuda. I just love her so much. She says, Dr. Clyde Winters, I honor and respect you love you so very. Thank you for helping us understand who we are and all the elements that got us from there to here. Thank you for that, Queen Mother Tiana. I love you so much. I see Troy Lena is out there. He was the first on the chat. So welcome, my brother. I see Dewan Banks, brother Nathaniel Turner is back with us. Hey, you got us. Yep, you got us on live, brother. Brother Bino, I see you. Nima, Nura, I see you out there. Who else is coming on? We got everybody coming on. We got B182. Jerome Walker is coming on, and everybody is chiming in. This is amazing. Now, today, Dr. Winters, you are going to talk to us about India up to the Aryan invasion. And of course, you've got a special report that is associated with that. I'm going to put that into the chat momentarily. But I assume you have a PowerPoint as well that you're going to queue up. But give us a little bit of an overview as to what we're going to be experiencing from this brilliant mind called that's housed in this body called Dr. Clyde Winters.
Okay, well, today what we're going to talk about is that I already talked about the various Dravidian people, and I mentioned the fact that I talked about the Dravidian people in India first, mainly because of the fact that they came directly from Africa. They belong to the C group people, and because they belong to the C group people, many of us are descendants of West Africans. You know, and they belong to the C group people too. But what I'm doing today is that I'm going to talk about those other Black people, those other Black people that contributed to the rise of Indian civilization. See, here's the whole point. You know, you're always taught that today you find a lot of people trying to say that this whole theory of Black people coming from Africa is a fraud. They're saying that the idea that the original man came from Africa has to be made up. Okay, I already showed you with the Dravidians that they came directly from Africa. But what you're going to learn today is that there's not just the so-called made-up genetic information, but we also have archaeological evidence. And that's what we're talking about today. That PDF that you're going to get here, this PDF is going to be the only place that you're going to find this information discussed. I searched around. I looked at a lot of books. I've looked at a lot of even a lot of magazine articles. And I'm sorry to tell you this, they don't really talk about the real history of ancient India. They don't talk about it because they want to always, in a sense, they have to fight. Because remember, when the British took over India, they liked that whole idea of the Aryan people. And they liked the idea of the Aryan people because the Aryans are supposed to represent the first white people and that they supposed to have brought a civilization in. And so what you find is that in India, the biggest problem now in India is that you have these people who are white or think they're white, you see. They're trying to keep down the people who they think are Black. The so-called Dalit people, the so-called other Black Indians. And see, in India, if you want to be successful, you have to be B1. Because in India, those Aryans, if they find a Muslim, if they find a Dalit, they'll burn your ass up in the street.
Wow. Burn
you up. Because they're Hindu.
Wow.
They're Hindutva. And the Hindutva, they're against dark people. Wow. They're against Muslim people. See?
Wow. So wasn't Gandhi also that? Wasn't Gandhi that way as well?
Gandhi was a racist person. Yes, he was racist.
Yes.
But see, the thing is, this is that. Remember, he came from South Africa. In South Africa for a great part of the time, and remember, in South Africa, in the Caribbean. And the white man was able, in a sense, to create a minority, a cadre of light-skinned people who they could use to dominate, you see, to dominate over the black-skinned people. White people always like to have a tether. And what a tether is that they like to have a tether, someone who can be that in-between person that the Black majority can be mad at. Like over here, Benjamin Franklin, they first had the so-called Mongoloid Indian. Mongoloid Indian didn't work. Then, in a sense, they started bringing people from Africa and people from the Caribbean. You know, just like remember in the 1970s, you know, there was a lot of Black power movements, a lot of shooting, a lot of killing. Back then, if a policeman killed a Black person, Black people would go kill a policeman. Now we just
That's true. That's true. That's now we mark. That is so true.
That's right.
Yes.
So, So the thing is, this is that.
That's why the Black Panthers were so revered, and why they had to go get FBI to go in there, because they were terrified. They were like, wait a minute, they're shooting back. What the fuck?
But they weren't the only one. You had the Republican New Africa. You had the black militancy. Remember there was one black group. They was killing so many police that they was hijacking planes to go to Algeria, to go to Cuba. Because the whole point is that, you know, back in the day, back then they used to carry shotguns in the police car. You know, a lot of times black people would attack the police car and steal a shotgun. But, you know, that's when people really accepted they were going to die. I didn't think I was going to live to be 21. Shit.
Me neither,
bro. I knew I was going to be dead.
I've got stories. Yeah. Absolutely. We all, from that time period, you came into existence. Yeah. That was a reality that, you know what? I'm going to die on my feet. I'm not going to die on my knees. I'm not going to die on my knees.
When I went to the University of Illinois, Champaign-Urbana. So I was walking. I said, Clyde, you know, the white people call me Superman.
How did they say that?
Clyde, why are you walking up? Clyde, why are you walking up and down the alleys? Why are you walking up and down the alleys, Clyde? I said, well, I came from Chicago, man. I had to know where the alleys is, because if I got to run, I'm gonna make it back.
That is a fact. I knew the alley sometimes more than I knew the streets. I'm telling you.
Man.
I am so serious.
I knew. I knew what backyard to go into so I could jump the fence.
Yes, 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 yes. I knew where the dogs were, where the dogs weren't. I knew it. Yeah. I would time it depending if the dog was on a chain or if the dog was walking around. I knew how to get around. Absolutely. Oh my gosh.
I didn't know. I didn't have to go to Vietnam. I was shot at so many times. And I wasn't even a gangbanger. I was a neutron.
I know, right? Truth comes out, family. Y'all don't know about all of our history. Oh, we went through it. That's so true, man. Brother. Chicago grooms you. It trains you, man.
It trains you.
And I think that's why I'm a militant to this day. I mean, I've always been. I mean, people never knew, but I've always been this dude. I just at one point just said F it, and I came out with my truth, which were these frequencies and what have you, you know.
because once you don't learn, I remember I used to tell my students when I used to teach, they said, Mr. Winters, you know, they said, you don't seem to be afraid of nothing. I said, I'll tell you why. I said, when I was in eighth grade at Vincent Upper Grade Center, I, you know, back in the day, you would always come home and at lunchtime, you go back home and watch Bozo Circus.
That's right.
But one day I decided.
Oh, you are my guy. Oh my gosh. Yes, you did. That is exactly what we did.
So I went out there. I ate at school. So I was standing in front of the door. And then these gangbangers came up. So a guy put a gun up to him and said, Can I shoot him? And so then I peed on myself. So I had to go home. After that, I said, I'll never be scared again. The thing is that taught me, man, that fear is worse than anything. Fear is worse
absolutely. Than absolutely. 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 Now, let me ask you this, Doc, because I had to do this, and I'm sure you went through this too, but I had to learn over time, and it was actually my queen that helped me with this. I had to really learn how to handle my rage. Because, you know, I left Chicago, came here to California. California's a little bit more laid back, obviously. But I had an edge to me when I got here. And my baby, she said, baby, you got that Chicago edge. You look like, if you haven't killed somebody, you look like you have about to or thinking about it. Because that's just, but I was that enraged. I was like on edge all the time. And California softens you a little bit, but it's what's in me is in me. I can't get it out, but I've learned over the years to curtail it and to try to calm myself down. But people really don't understand how close people have gotten to that Chicago coming out, man.
But you know, like up until I was 40 years old, over the summer, people say, say, why you always got a jacket? Up to when I was 40 years old, I always carried a jacket. And the reason mm-hmm. I wore a jacket is I grew up around some Puerto Ricans. And so I had that jacket so I could wrap it around my arms, man, if they came
That's
in
right.
with a knife.
That's it. That's right.
I don't have to add so much, but I will tell you this. If I ride the L train, the old L, mm-hmm. once mm-hmm. I got to 47, mm-hmm. man, once mm-hmm. I went past 47, mm-hmm. my old mm-hmm. man went to mm-hmm. say, I got to fight. Mm-hmm. I got to stop.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So, you know, amen.
I think that's the worst thing. But like in my neighborhood, like we used to living in Chicago when I grew up, and I had a kids, and I'm teaching. Mm-hmm. I'm rocking about the mm-hmm. house. Hey, folks. Hey, folks, please love me too.
Right.
We all
right.
folks. No, I'm not right. folks.
No, I'm not folks, man. I'm not folks. I'm people. Not vice lord. I'm not disciple. Yeah. I'm not none of that. No, I'm not none of that.
No.
But
no,
yeah.
No. But again,
memories, again, reminiscing.
Those were the days, man. Jumping off rooftops,
yes.
jumping off second floor.
Yes, sir.
Man,
yes,
hell.
Sir. Yes,
but
sir.
Again, we're not talking about that. I'm sorry, people.
I know. We digress. We just, hey, me and Clyde just go. We're going back. We having a mini ripping moment. Okay, we just reminiscing back here. Let me go back and Rosa Campson. I see you came on. Hotep Goddess Al Ford, Troy Lena. I apologize. You're a female, a woman. I think I said you were a dude. I apologize, Goddess. So I wanted to give you a big up and acknowledgement of that. Who else? Sandra Hinton, she's come on. What's going on? Toya E is with us. Brother Akil is with us. Reba Henderson is back with us. Pharaoh Tut is back with us. And so I just we got King Stark and All the Way Free is also with us. So we appreciate all of you coming on. Oh, Lord, we got over 100 people already on here right now. We ain't even started the show. All right. Well, let's get on with it then, Dr. Winters. But even though we were reminiscing and talking about what we were talking about in terms of being that, you know, Chicago and that kind of mindset, that warrior mindset, that's also African. That's also first frequency. Speak to us about that and as it relates to this presentation with India before the Aryan invasion. And are you going to go into the Aryan invasion at any point in time later on? In the series. Oh, okay, great. Oh, yeah, wonderful, wonderful. Yay. Okay.
This is going to be, as I said before, this PDF. You're not going to find it anywhere else. You're not going to find the information anywhere else because see, what I've done in this PDF and what I'm going to do in this discussion is I'm going to show you how when they say that Black people expanded from Africa to different parts of the world, you have mm-hmm. receipts. And see, the receipts is what's called archaeological evidence. It's the archaeological evidence that shows where people came from. Let me explain.
Okay.
If the earliest so-called artifacts were found in a specific location, namely in Africa, that means that's where the people came from.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Because if they appeared in Africa, let's say around 100,000 BC, and then appear in America by 95,000 BC, that shows a 5,000-year difference. And see, this mm-hmm. is what people understand. And again, just like Keisha Cole and these Black Hebrews or these Black Muslims or these Moors, so many people are trying to run away from who and what they are.
Mm-hmm.
Who and
mm-hmm.
what
Ashe.
They are. My heritage
Ashe.
Is Mississippi, Ashe. Black Indian, Choctaw. And African, my ancestry is African. That's where my people came from. See, these white people here, they came from Europe. Mm, they came from Europe. Mm-hmm. And see, to be B1, you have to learn how to control yourself. When I was growing up, mm-hmm. in a sense, I don't think I was third frequency
mm-hmm.
or fourth frequency.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, I wasn't necessarily first frequency. You see,
mm-hmm.
My mind growing up was, you walk down the street, the police will grab you, throw you up against the car. You know the lick, nigga.
Mm-hmm,
I knew what to do
mm-hmm.
up against that car, spread my leg.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm,
you know?
Mm-hmm,
and then keep
mm-hmm.
my mouth shut.
That's right.
And this always mm-hmm. happened walking down the street, but I knew
That's
what
right.
to do, you see?
Right.
But at the same time, it was my father one day. My father said, Clyde. I came home and I said, we got to turn this mother out. You know, I said, we got to turn this mother out. Black power, Daddy-O. I said, calm down. I said, Daddy-O, we got to turn this mother out. He said, no. What you have to do is you have to realize that you have to fight him, but you have to use your head. Use your mind. You see? You can't always let your enemy know what you're doing. You see?
That's right. Never let the left hand know what the right hand is doing. That's right.
Left hand knows what your right hand doing. You know, just like I was listening to Tariq today. Rashid was talking about that he wants to buy a new property, and he said he told everybody what I want about a property. I'll be interested to see if he's able to buy this property, because he did that before. But they might sell it this time. But again, in a sense, the European is not going to do anything to help facilitate you knowing who you are.
That's right. That's right.
He fights too hard for this. And he knows that the way to do that is to hold you back by not allowing you to know your history.
Disrupting and interrupting that frequency. Absolutely.
Yeah. See, in second frequency, they're you know, they're on their back foot now, you know?
Yeah.
You know, and that's the way it is. You know, I'm really sad. When I was teaching in sixth grade, my kids would want to say, I want to go fight. I was next to the back door. So I said, okay, I'll take them. I said, go ahead and fight. What? Aren't you going to stop us, Mr. Winters? No. I said, go ahead and fight. But can you do this? I said, nobody know but me and you. I ain't going to tell nobody. Well, I don't want to fight. Okay, let's go back in. See? You know, because see, you have to, in a sense, you have to understand, you see, you have to understand that there is a certain moderation, just like me and you was talking. That's why when a lot of immigrants come over here, they can't understand why we're ready to die. But they think it's silly. We will fight.
Right.
When you see an old black woman fighting and protesting, you know, I want to hurry up and get to the thing, but it's just like my mother. My mother, when I was growing up, if I fell down, I could say, Mama, I hurt my knee. She'd say, get over there, Clyde. Be a man. Stop. Don't cry.
That's right.
And then my sisters, if they cried, oh, baby, let me kiss it. Let me hold it. And so I used to say to myself, damn, that ain't fair. So I got older. So I got grown. And so, I graduated from university. I had a master's degree. I had a BA degree. I got my master's and BA all in the same year. I only went to summer school once because I liked school. So I was complaining, saying, yeah, you know, the white man this, the white man that, I should have a job right here. I was talking to my grandmother. She said, Clyde, stop. I said, what? She said, stop. I said, I do not like a black man who's always complaining. You take your lesson, you move on with it. Oh! So my mama wasn't wrong. Because, see, my mother was preparing me to how to deal in this world. To deal this world, you had to stand tall and you had to stand flat-footed and two-footed.
And strong.
I told my father, I said, Daddy, I want to learn karate. He said, I can't teach you no karate, but I can teach you karazan. He said, that's good. Whatever you can when you get in a fight. Karazan.
That's right. That's right. I don't know karate, but I know karaza.
My father said,
I love that. I love that.
If you get in a fight, you turn the other cheek.
That's right.
I said, what do you mean? He said, you turn the other cheek. Because when they coming for that right cheek, you turn that cheek, let that fist go past, baby.
Come back with that left. That's right. Oh, my gosh. I'm going to start calling you Pop Pop.
I stay in my place.
We ain't going to let nobody bother you, man. We ain't going to let nobody bother you. And you got some good sons too. You got there ain't nobody gonna do nothing with you. Trust me. Trust me on that. I got tentacles everywhere. But by the way, where is it? I saw it in the chat. I'm gonna ask, is it Carol Asperam? Carol Asperam, I see your question. You probably will need to ask it later. Well, let's see. Let me put it up on the screen for Dr. Winters, because you also asked, I think, in the comment section, but I don't know if this is the place for it, but I'm putting it up here for Dr. Winters because I know you already addressed this, Dr. Winters. What show does she need to watch to already confirm this?
The one we did on the spread of black people. I saw him hotep. He's a good hustler, but I saw him hotep. He teaches whatever he wants to teach, but he doesn't know what he's talking about. But again, he does a lot of videos. He does a lot of tapes. He has his shows. But again, he doesn't like me. I don't really care because the thing is, this is that I've already talked about the Semitic people and the spread. Look in the language, the one that we do on
the language. Okay, let me find that and I'll put that in the chat for her. But go ahead and continue. And I've got another question here. Let me see. Hold on. We're doing this show different today, boy. This is fascinating. Y'all are up in here. And thank you for that answer, Dr. Winters. Is it Tanet? Dr. Winters, I never believed in the out of Africa theory. I thought it was put into place to remove all indigenous people from their lands by stating we all come from Africa. That's fascinating. Do you want to break that down for her?
Okay, the out of Africa theory, you have to understand what it says, is that the out of Africa theory, the Europeans developed the out of Africa theory because of the fact that we carry 9 strands in terms of, and because of the fact that our ancestry is so old, then we had to come from that. Also, remember, the white people say the out of Africa theory because of the fact that he wants to have a place in history. No white people ever came out of Africa. No Mongoloid people ever came out of Africa.
Ashe, that's correct.
The out of Africa theory simply means that man originated in Africa and he expanded worldwide. You see. The white man knows that the indigenous people everywhere were black, but the whole point is that by saying everybody came out of Africa, that's to negate the significance of black people. You got to understand.
That's right.
Right. See, black people think the out of Africa theory is to demonize the fact that there were black Indians, in North America, or that there were black people. No. That's not what it's all about. The out of Africa theory is simply a theory that says man came from Africa, and then the white man says, since all man came from Africa, we African too. No, you're not.
Right. No, you're not.
You're not first frequency.
You are not first frequency. I'm going to put you in the Maury Povich. We're going to get you a Maury Povich shirt or something. You are not first frequency. And watch all the white people just fly off and just go crazy like they do on Maury. Oh, that's hilarious. I love it.
No, it's not. It's just to see the DNA fit. Back in the 80s, when I would be debating people, these white people always say, well, the DNA this, the DNA that. And so then back then, I said, damn, whoa, what is this? But then when I started seeing that, the DNA said no such thing. See, because they based this on the idea that black people and white people were separated for 70,000 years. That's a lie. Black people went to Europe in 711 AD. They were the Moors. They moved all the way to Germany. And they ruled these people for 1,000 years. Then therefore, the whole foundation of population genetics is all false. See? But then,
I put that link too. That was show number 6, Dr. Winters.
I think it was Carol, what we did on the language.
African Origins of Contemporary Languages. That's for Carol and anyone else who wanted to deal with the Asar Imhotep piece. So much love and all of that, but this is where we come to get it corrected, to get it insulated, isolated, and explained. And thank you, Tanette. That was a great question because it's not, I'm so happy you asked, because sometimes people feel like, oh, I don't want to ask, I don't want to look. No, ask not because you're weak, ask because you want to become strong so you can get it right. And this is the brother that's going to be able to do it. This is the elder. Go ahead, Baba.
And not only that, but see, I notice people some are suggesting shows that I should do in the comments. Many of these shows have already been done. Mm-hmm. So I would advise some of you to go back and look at the shows from week two after critical race theory. We go into these various historical experiences that relate to our Black people, So again, a lot of this stuff has already been discussed. But again, I'm here to bring the proof. I'm not here to argue with anybody. You see,
right. This is not a debate show. Yes,
I bring the evidence, then I give you the PDF, and in the PDF, I usually have references, and these references can back up what I'm saying. You know, I saw Imhotep. He's an okay person, but some of the things he believed, those are things that he believed. But see, I don't make my living off of this.
Mm-hmm.
I made my living as a teacher. I made my living as a professor.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I got a pigeon right now. Right now I got one.
So then, hopefully they won't change it up on you. And you gotta get you gotta get the jab to get your pigeon. Hopefully they won't do that to you.
That's right. But see, a lot of these people, they made their money off hustling. They made their money off taking people on trips to Africa, trips to Mexico, trips to Egypt. That's how they live. That's how they survive. I didn't survive like that.
Absolutely. I'm putting in the chat for the beloved out there, Dr. Winter's channel. He has a channel on our platform. All of his appearances are there. And so you can just go. It's an institution. That playlist right now is an institution. It's a university. So go to that playlist and go through and also get the PDFs, because that is where you can get the unequivocal argument. And now you sit on top of the arguments of the debates, because you now have the unequivocal evidence. And so you can really, truly argue. When you sometimes watch these programs from some of the other scholars, you have been trained to be in that fourth frequency space of debating and fighting and making people wrong. Nothing's wrong. Something's happened to us. And so there's a certain level of behavior that we're trying to get out of to go back into our first frequency behavior.
And this is what
it looks like on this particular platform. Go ahead, Doc.
And other people like Asai Imhotep and a few other people, they want to try to make it appear as though they're smarter than Diop. So they haven't read the stuff from Diop. They haven't read the stuff from John Jackson. And so they're trying to make it appear that they're the new people on the block. I pay homage to our ancestor, our heroes.
Absolutely. College,
because I learned from them. I don't mind talking about their research, but a lot of these new jacks, what they want to do is they want to make it appear as though they know more than anybody else. See,
I've seen that. I've sensed that. Yes.
And so then when they talk about Semitic people, the white man said they came from Asia. So if the white man said it, gotta be right, Diablo. Right. You know it's right. The white man said,
"Didn't
the white man say it?"
Clyde Winters, you are not second frequency.
when Imhotep and them other people says it came, it had come. The white man said, "White man."
You know y'all know. You are so bad. Y'all need to know what I go through on the phone with this man. If you see him like this, imagine what I go through on the phone with this man. Oh, you are just tearing it up tonight. You are tearing it up tonight. I love you so.
Can I go to the presentation? Let's get started.
Please. Please do. Oh, my gosh. Okay, so let me know when you have it in the green room there, and I'll pull it up on the screen for the community.
Okay. I'm sorry. I'm sorry, guys.
Don't apologize.
It's not your
fault. Yeah, right.
blame it on the other brother.
Blame it on the minister. That's right. Pass it on.
Yes,
that's right.
Yes,
oh, I love it. Oh, they got me crying over here. Oh, my goodness. Okay, here we go. All right, I see you coming on. There we go. And we are going to go full screen with you. There it is. All right, Doc, knock it out. I'm going to mute my mic. What is the Southern dispersal? What was the question? What is the Southern dispersal route out of Africa?
Let's start with
okay,
that.
Okay, the southern dispersal route is the route in which people expanded. What you got to understand is that modern humans probably entered India between 130,000 and 70,000 BC. When we think about modern man, we're not talking about Homo erectus. We're not talking about Neanderthal man. Many people try to say that Neanderthal man was not a modern human being. They say that because of the fact that when white people discovered Neanderthal man in Europe, they found that Neanderthal man, all of his features was Negroid. So they said, that can't be us. So then they developed the myth that Neanderthal man was not human. But we do have this whole idea that anatomically modern humans are supposed to be from what we're descended from. The anatomically modern humans, they appear in Africa around 200,000 years ago. And what's very interesting is that we find that the people who first show up in India, they used the southern route to get to India. What that means is that they went through Arabia, then through Iran, and then they walked into India. Also, another way that they could have went into India is that they could have come across Kumarinadu. And anybody that's been associated with this, listening to my talk for the past few weeks, you know that Kumarinadu was the landmass that connected Africa to India. Well, this is archaeological stuff that's called the Hohenzollern port stuff. And the Hohenzollern port stuff, that's where there's a certain assemblage of tools. They call Levalosis tools. And these tools were carved bones, ultra paint, and perforated seashells. The thing is this, is that you can see this picture. And in this picture, it shows the artifacts that are associated with the Hohenzollern port culture. And see, the interesting thing is that these same artifacts, these same type of instruments, these same type of tools, these same type of colors that was found in South Africa at Hohenzollern also occurring in India. So this means, in a sense, that we have direct evidence that people from South Africa between 130,000 years ago came to India. That's right, they migrated to India. You know, but then they say that one of the things that could have stopped it is that they feel that some of the evidence of this early migration of Black people out of Africa and India could have also been complicated by what's called the Toba volcano. Many researchers believe that there was a major volcano around 74,000 years ago. And they believe that this volcano destroyed much of the Indian civilizations. It destroyed many of the ancient civilizations they believe around the world. Because of this volcano, especially in Asia, many places that were formerly inhabited by people were covered with this ash, covered with this dust. And because of the Toba volcano, what it did is that they believe that it killed a lot of people off. But then again, there is some research that shows what people were there. But the most important thing to remember is that we have direct archaeological evidence that Black people from South Africa carried their civilization, their culture into Arabia, Mesopotamia, and finally into India. You know, some of the ancient sites for these things are found in what's called the Daba and Jawalapuram. At Daba and Jawalapuram, you find many, in a sense, artifacts. And these artifacts go back to the Hohenzollern port artifacts that we looked at a little while ago. And this shows that as early as 74,000 to 65,000 years ago, people were living in these sites, you know.
Fantastic, Doc. Now, let's explain about the peopling of Africa. Of India. How does that work out?
Okay, well, we see the same thing that occurred in Africa. We know that the mm-hmm. first people that came into existence, the first anatomically modern humans, we believe were the Austrians. You see? You know, but in India, the Australians are not called Australian people. These Australoid people are called Veddoids. These are the Veddoid people. And so they call the Australoid people Veddoids. And these were the first people to leave Africa. You know, these were the Australians, but they have a different name for them in India. The Veddoid people introduced the Horus and Portus that we talked about earlier, and they probably lived at Daba, and Jawalapuram. But see, the thing about this is that they haven't been able to find yet any real ancient skeletons in India. Mm. For some reason, they haven't been able to find any ancient skeletons. As you can see, these are some of the pictures on the right side. You can see pictures of people who are related to the Australoid race, you know, West Australoid, the Tasmanians, the Barinians, the Paleomelanated, the Neomelanated. And so as you can see, but these people, I'm going to talk about the Australian people next week. Next week, I'm going to talk about how Australia was settled and how Melanesia was settled. So I hope that some of you can find the time to come back next week, and you're going to get a more detailed discussion of how the Australians left Africa, 130,000, between 130 and 65,000 years ago, and began to settle much of the world. You know, the next population to enter India was probably the Austro-Asiatics, or Munda people. When you think about the Munda people, you had to think about the so-called Khoisan, the Khoisan of South Africa. The Khoisan and the Munda people are kind of related. And we know in a sense that the Munda people, they found the earliest culture in Indus Valley. See, even before the Dravidians got into the Indus Valley, the Munda people had developed a civilization at Margarth around 6,000 BC. See, if you look at these pictures on the left, you can see that in this picture of the Cambodian people, you can see that, look at that. Look at the way that the hair is made around around this figure from ancient Cambodia. This is one of the Munda people. And then look at down below it. You can see the statues from McGirth. And these statues from McGirth, they're 6,000 years old. And that shows that the Munda people today are people who they consider to be very primitive. At one time, had their own civilization in India. And during this civilization, they grew various cereals. They had goats, they had sheep, and they grew wheat. Remember when we talked last week about the Dravidian people? When we talked about the Seagroup people. The Seagroup people, they didn't usually cultivate wheat. They usually cultivated millet. But these Munda people, they cultivated wheat. Here you see, in a sense, that there's a people that are still left. The Gundi were originally Munda speakers. The Gu community is widespread because the ancestors of people living in the eight states recognize that the Indus Valley culture is related to the Gundi. And so look, we find at McGirth those statues I talked about. And then you see some of these statues are found at some of the Indus Valley sites. And then you can see a Gundi woman. And this Gundi woman, it was her ancestors who developed this great civilization. You see?
Amazing.
And the Munda people, they developed a civilization in Mahagarth and at the Rakikari, you know, sites. And these sites date between 7,000 years before in the Christian area, up to 2,500 BC. At the 2,500 BC, between 2400 BC, we see the Dravidians come. But before the Dravidian civilization came, the Munda people had their own civilization. Yes. You're not going to find this in any other book, because those Aryans, those so-called white people who rule India today, who run the government, they don't want you to know about these black people and their contribution to civilization. They're trying to say all civilization came from those Indo-Aryan or white people. Just like over here, white man always has to lie. And even though these may be brown-skinned white people, they still want to deny any efforts of the B1. You got to be B1 to see the truth.
No doubt.
Also, we find very few Anu. There's no Anu people left in India. The only Anu people that you find, and the Anu people, they left Africa after the so-called Munda Khoisan people. And the Anu people, you mainly find them on the islands. Mm-hmm. You find them on mm-hmm. the islands. You know, the Anu people are mainly the Anu people found on the Andaman Islands. If you remember a couple of years ago, some white people came to the Andaman Islands and they greeted him all right. They left his ass dead on the coast. They said, come back and get this guy. We don't want him.
Oh, my God. So Dr. Andaman- Winters? I want to, if I could, I'm going to put this up on the screen because I think it's meritus. Hold on a second. I just want to put this up on the screen. Tanya E., I think, brings a very good point, and it needs to be said. I think many people get caught up on these hair and skin colors. Most people don't understand that both hair and skin color literally mutates according to the climate environmentally generally. Can you speak to that? Because that's basically what we're talking about here. We're talking about ancestry. We're not talking about how the climate changes with various different hair textures and so on. Or how does that go? How does that go, Doc? I just wanted to thank you for that, Tanya.
The hair texture, it can change depending upon the climate. The hair color can change. But usually, in a sense, skin color, that doesn't necessarily change. For example, you know, the Eskimos, they live in the Arctic, but they're still dark. But what you find in a sense is that it's the development of the creation of species. Different species appearing on the earth at different times. I talk about that in week two, week three. Week mm-hmm. three, the race mm-hmm. races, I think I talk about it. Those of you mm-hmm. who want to find mm-hmm. out more about that should go and look at the video for week three. You know, there I talk about the races. And then week four, I talk about the expansion of the races. And so then hair can be influenced by the climate. Now this is it. Now facial features can be determined by your diet. If you eat certain foods, you can see how people look differently. Like if you looked at my yearbook and looked at some of the sisters that I was in school with, they look pretty hard. But after we graduated and things became better and we ate different diets, then our facial features changed. But black people, foundational black Americans, we used to eat the best diet that ever existed on the planet Earth. You know, now we eat bad foods. But again, climate can influence your hair texture.
Okay.
But it doesn't really influence the skin color. They used to say that vitamin D had an influence on skin color. Nah. You know, and I just think traditionally black people, look at the ancient Egyptians and others, and you just see it's always been some light-skinned black people, some dark-skinned black people, you know. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, and and then if light-skinned people keep marrying each other, they're gonna look all light-skinned. If super mm-hmm, dark-skinned mm-hmm. people keep marrying each other, they're gonna look super 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 dark. So again, diet can influence your facial features. Diet can influence your facial features. Climate can influence your hair, but ecological conditions and climate it cannot really influence your color. The only people that really had a change, not the white Arabs, but the so-called Caucasians. Now, when black people went into the caves during the last ice age, they devolved and they lost their pigmentation. But that was mm-hmm, because of the mm-hmm. fact that anything under the earth in the caves, they turned very pale. And that's how those people lost it. But just weather naturally, nah. Okay, so then you find that most of the Anu people or the pygmy people, they lived in a sense on the various islands. And the only pygmy people around India live on the Andamanese island. And these people, the pygmy people or the Anu on the islands, they always call them Negrito. And Negrito is a Spanish word that means little Negroes, you say. And so then only the Andamanese and the Sentinelese, those are the only people who are considered to be pygmies. And these pygmies, they do not like white people, And if a white person comes on their island, they kill them.
You know? Wow.
They might kill a brother, but I'm not going to find out.
I ain't going to go find out, brother. Not, yeah, absolutely. I'll send something prior to and say, hey, can I come on board? That's all I'm saying. I
yes, ain't going to send them an email.
That's why black people right now, they knock on my door. It's like, you better call first. You better don't just show up. Don't just show up.
Call first.
Call first.
you got to remember that tall-skinned black people have a bad tradition because we used to steal pygmy women. And we used to steal koi women, you know, because, you know, for some reason, women who are short, they look kind of cute, sexy, whatever. So they got to protect their women.
That's right.
You know, they got to protect the cuties. But anyway,
you got to learn our history.
They're mainly on the islands. But they also have this guy named Rasimhan. He developed this whole idea of what he called the ancient ancestral South Indians.
Mm.
And he said that the oldest inhabitants of India, he calls them the ancient ancestral South Indians. And he said he believes that the ancestors of all the people in India, he believes were people from the Andaman Islands and the Veddoid people. He believed that the Andaman Islanders or the Pygmy Anu people and the Veddoid people were the first people to really live in India. Some of the people who represent these ancient ancestral South Indians, they're called tribal people in the literature. And these tribal people include the Paniya, the Arula, the Saliga. And these people, in a sense, they believe could represent the original inhabitants. They carry Y-DNA haplogroup H. And Y-DNA haplogroup H is interesting. When they found Y-DNA haplogroup H among the cities, and the cities people, S-I-D-D-I, these are people who are descendants of slaves who were taken to India from East Africa. They say that haplogroup Y, haplogroup H, is an identifier of your Negro heritage. But whenever they find Y-DNA haplogroup H in anybody else, that has nothing to do with the Negro. So again, it's gobbledygook. It's double speech. And often when you're trying, in a sense, to determine the ancient history of black people, you run into this whole idea of double speech. And this double speech is where they give you different meanings of different words so they can throw you off into a confused manner.
Ashe, thank you for that.
Again, we talked about the melanated Dravido-African. We talked about the fact, in a sense, that the Dravidians, you know, they also lived in India. We know that one of the main gods of the Dravidians is Marungu. And Marungu is a mountain god. But, you know, you might be surprised to find out that 23 people in Africa worship the same god.
Marungu.
See, it's another indication of where the Dravidians came from. And among the Dravidians, the Ali Tadavitar, you know, their system of inheritance passes from the uncle to his nephews.
Mm.
I repeat, from the uncle to his nephews instead of to his sons, you know? That's called Marumakal Tayam, as in Africa. And in both South India and Western Sudan, Africa, the dead were buried in terracotta jars, you know? So again, there is this relationship. We talked about it.
Okay, so are the Indo-Aryans who live in North India native to India?
That's a good question, you see. You know, in recent years, the Aryans are beginning to try to say that they've always been in India.
Mm-hmm.
The Aryans are trying to say that it was the Dravidians and the Munda and the Pygmies, Anu people, who came into India after they had already settled. That's a lie, you see.
Mm-hmm.
But remember, Indo-Aryans, mm-hmm. just like second frequency, they try to make a lot of different artifacts. They try to make a lot of different art. And they try to develop this art. They make these artifacts to make it appear as though they founded a civilization.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes. Mm-hmm. That's why wow. Even though we had a black Buddha, they made white Buddhas and try to destroy the black Buddha.
Mm-hmm. Ashe.
Because they have to try to get themselves a history.
Right.
Just like how Second Frequency tries to give themselves a history over here in the United States. They try to give themselves a history in Europe. The Indo-Aryan people in India, they try to give themselves a history too. They try to make it appear as though they are native to India, but they're not. There are many links between the Indian and Iranian language. In fact, when they talk about the Indo-European language, that's a made-up language. Indo-European never existed. Indo-European shows mainly a relationship between Greek and Sanskrit.
Mm-hmm.
But see, you can explain the relationship between Greek and Sanskrit because of the fact that when Sanskrit was created in Pakistan, it was Greeks living in the area. So when the Greeks ruled Europe, many people learned Greek. Therefore, in many European languages, they have Greek vocabulary. Secondly, when the Romans conquered parts of Europe, they didn't use Latin. They mainly, in a sense, made their state language Greek. That's why you find all these Greek words in European languages that relate to Sanskrit words. Because some of these Sanskrit words came from ancient Greek. A guy called Panini is supposed to have written the grammar for the Sanskrit language. And this is how, in a sense, many of those Greek words came into Sanskrit, which really, in a sense, had what's called a Dravidian or Tamil substratum. What I mean by a substratum is that when you look under the underlying foundation of Sanskrit, is really, in a sense, a Tamil language, you see. But, you know, Indo-Europeans, they took a lot of their words from the Munda. They took a lot of their words from the Dravidians. But much of the vocabulary of the Indo-Aryan or Aryan languages relate to the various Iranian groups.
Dr. Winters, it wasn't a lingua, what do you call it, a lingua franca?
Or one of my, I promised that one of the guys in the earlier group that I wouldn't use the word lingua franca. I would use, you know, Shanga.
Oh, I remember that. Mm-hmm.
Maluga. What that means is it's a mixture of language. So a lingua franca is a language that has a mixture of words from other languages in that language. And that's how, in a sense, people are able to communicate it, because it's kind of, in a sense, a mixed language. Some people call it indigenous or whatever. For example, we talked about earlier, when I talked about Egypt as a pan-African civilization, is that, that ancient Egyptian is, in a sense, Shanga Ya Maluga, a language that's a mixture of all these different West African languages. And that's why we're able, in a sense, to compare ancient Egyptian to West African languages and find a connection. We find a connection because many of the people who live in West Africa today were part of the ancient Egyptian nation. Ancient Egypt was a confederation. It was made up of various sipats. Each sipat had its own god, and they probably spoke different languages. But what it is that they were able to invent the ancient Egyptian language so that everybody could have a common means of communication. You see?
Thank you.
Just like in the old days, the Arabs who came to trade in East Africa and the Bantu people who lived in East Africa, they created a trade language. And that trade language was called Kiswahili. Nina Sama Kiswahili, do you speak Swahili? See? But the point is this, is that it was a combination of Arabic words and Bantu words. And see, this is very important to understand that Black people are unique people. We're unique people because even though we may speak a lot of different languages, then we may come together and form a language in which we could communicate. I mean, when I was growing up, we used to have pimp talk. And you know, so people, you know, it was a language that we had created. I think the jazz musicians had created it. Then they married Akiba. She made a language too. We say, you know, and so then, but the thing is this, so Black people are very creative. We're creative people. Mm-hmm, it's like we've created various musical forms. We've also created various language. Okay, the Indo-European language are spoken over a wide area of Eurasia. There are many theories about where the homeland of these people can be found. The Anatolian hypothesis had a good fit for Indo-European. In other words, they want to say that the Indo-European people probably developed Anatolia. And these people in Anatolia, which we would call Mesopotamia, part of Mesopotamia today, were in a sense the Hittites. See, the white man, the second frequency is always trying to say that everything came from them. And so since everything came from second frequency, they always try to pinpoint specific areas where their ancestors were, when their ancestors maybe didn't do as much as they said. But the only problem with this theory that the earliest Indo-European culture came from Anatolia is that Anatolia was ruled by the Kaska, and the Hatti, not Hittites. The Hittites, they came in later. But Anatolia is ruled by the Kaska and the Hatti. And as we talked about last week, these were Black people who came directly from Africa. You know, they're called Hattili. The gods of the Hatti people was Kashu and Kusu. Do you see that? Kashu.
Wow. Come on, man. Oh, come on.
Yes.
That's dope. That is dope. I love that. And Troy Lena, I love what she says too. Troy Lena says, look, I don't have to get my ancestry. I could just do it. I don't have to go to ancestry to find out if I'm African. I just need Dr. Winters. I love that. You got Dr. Winters, Troy Lena. Absolutely. We all do. Thank you for that. This was amazing. Okay, Kush, I love that connection. Thank you for that, Doc. There it is, right there. Wow. Keep going.
How did people related to the Hatiu? One of the Egyptian Delta Tehinu. Remember, I told you that the Tehinu tribe, the Tehinu people, in a sense, were related to the C group people of Nubia, and that the Dravidians are descendants of the Tehinu. See? But the white man, the second frequency, they're not going to tell you that because they try to tell you that the Tehinu were white people. Get out of here. The Tamahu, they say they were white people. But that's because later white people adopted their name. White people, I mean, second frequency is always still in our names. They pretend. The Hurrians spoke a non-Indo-European language. Formerly, linguists suggested that the Hurrians were dominated by Indic speakers. Linguists of the IE languages were fond of this theory because some of the names for the earliest Indo-Aryan gods, chariots, horsemanship, are found in Hurrian. Yes. Yes, when you really study Indo-European languages, they didn't have a culture. They didn't even have a name for the horse. They didn't have a name for chariots or wagons. They got everything from the Black people who lived in Mesopotamia, Anatolia. Just like today, they steal your history. They steal your culture. They stole their history, their culture. They stole the Hatik, the Kaska. They stole their history and culture. For example, let's look at Hurrian and Sanskrit. In Hurrian, we have Mitra. In Sanskrit, we have Mitra. In Hurrian, we have Aruna. In Sanskrit, we have Varuna. In Hurrian, we have Indara. In Sanskrit, we have Indra. What does this tell you? The Hurrian language, is over 1,000 years older than Sanskrit. So where did they get these words from? They got it from Black people. They got it from people like you. They got it from people who recognized that they were B1. See, a lot of people, they try to tell you that there was no such thing as Black people. But as soon as second frequency came on the scene, being darker than them became an issue.
There it is. Wow.
It became an issue. because they had to find a place to say they were who they were. The Anatolian theory for the origin of Indo-European speakers was held in high regards until Bedard Caldwell studied 500 Hurrian names. Caldwell studied 500 Hurrian names.
Wow.
And he found that only 5 out of 500 were Indo-Aryan. What does that mean?
Oh, my God.
That means that in a sense that no, they weren't Indo-Aryans. They weren't Indo-Europeans. These were Black people. This made it clear that the Indo-Aryan people, they learned about how to ride a horse, how to use a chariot, how to use a sword.
My.
They learned it from you. Mm. They learned it from first frequency.
Mm.
But see,
not sure.
Second frequency and the white Arabs, they always came around us. They come around us real humble. Hey, brother. Can you give me a hand? Can you give me some soup? Can you give me something to eat? Man, you know, we were a kind people. Okay, right. Second frequency. Okay, white Arab. Come on in.
Mm-hmm.
And it was okay as long as it was 5. Then it got to be 35. Then it got to be 100.
Mm-hmm.
And it was only 20 of you. And you know what they did when it was only 20 of you?
Mm-hmm.
They exterminated your ass.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Europeans, second frequency.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Come on.
They
there it is.
Took over the world because they would come in humble, then exterminate you.
Oh, that's so good,
Doc. In the Thanksgiving broadcast. In the Thanksgiving broadcast, I told you how the Europeans have been giving gifts to the Black Indians
on
the East Coast of the United States for 20 years before they sent the pilgrims, before they sent the great humble British people there. But those gifts was infected with smallpox. They gave them smallpox blankets.
That's right.
So when the white man came, he had plenty of cabins to live in, because he just moved into the cabins that was left empty by the Black Indians who got a gift from second frequency.
There it is. There it is. Bring it. Bring it, Doc.
You take a gift from second frequency, usually that gift is gone. You up. I'm just saying. Over understand.
Speak truth to power. Speak truth to power. There it is.
They did it to the Black Indians.
That's right.
They did it to the Blacks in Anatolia. They did it to the Tasmanians. They give you a gift and it usually fuck you up.
That's it. That's it.
They got another gift for you too. You can take it if you wish.
No, thank you.
Anatolia was probably not the home of the Indo-Aryan speakers. Anatolia was probably the home of the Indo-Aryans. Now, this is something interesting. You know, I really studied this for a long time. Where did these Indo-Aryans come from? You know, okay, although the Indo-Europeans didn't come from India, the Indo-Aryans, they probably came from Anatolia, you see.
Mm.
Over time, the Hittites defeated the Hadi and the Kaska and other peoples belonging to the Hurrian and Mitanni nation. These people were uprooted and forced into Iran. In other words, in a sense, when the Hittites came in, they ran out many of the Black tribes, the Hadi and the Kaska. When the Hadi and the Kaska left Anatolia, they moved into Iran. When they moved into Iran, they lived among a bunch of nomadic people, you know. Because, see, the only place they could go to was to Iran. They couldn't go back in Africa, and they couldn't go back in Egypt because it was so full of people. So the Hadi and Kaska, they moved to Iran. When they got to Iran, they ran into a lot of Iranian-speaking people, and these people were nomads. They had no culture. They had no civilization. So they accepted these Black people, the Indo-Aryans accepted them, and they accepted them because they could take advantage of their ideas about culture and civilization, you see? That's one of the reasons why we find a relationship between the Indo-Aryans, Indo-Aryan gods and the Hurrian gods, is because they adopted the gods of these Black people once they settled in the area. In Iran, they probably formed a significant portion of the Proto-Aryan population. In other words, the Hadi and the Kaska, who were black people, they formed the foundation or the basis of the people who became later in life Aryan. You got to remember that the word Aryan or Aryan, that doesn't mean in a sense white. The word Aryan is a Dravidian word, which means noble. So an Aryan person was supposed to be a noble person, a person who was well-born, a person in a sense who had high civilization, you see?
Mm-hmm.
It had nothing to do with second frequency or white Aryan. Aryan just meant a high-born person, a noble person. You know, it was there in Iran where these Hurrians met, you know, Iranian-speaking people. And these Iranian-speaking people, they adopted the culture, you see.
Mm-hmm.
Iranian speakers probably intermarried with the Kaska and Hurrian people, who are predominantly dark-skinned. Joining forces with Mitannian Hurrian exiles, they attacked Dravidian and Austronesian-speaking people who probably lived in walled cities. That's why we're going to talk about this later. But see, whenever you read the Rig Veda, the Red Veda always talks about the fort punishers, you know, tearing down the walls. Because see, the Dravidians and the Munda people, they lived in walled cities. They lived in cities. But see, those Indo-Aryans wanted to get into those cities. Because it was in those cities where they could find gold, silver, and other riches, you see?
Mm-hmm.
See? And so then these Indo-Aryans, these mixed white and black people who later turned into the white people we see in Iran and India today, light-skinned people we see in India today, these people, in a sense, they adopted this culture, but they were nomads. They had nothing. See, when they came into India, they had nothing. Nothing.
Wow.
And so when they came in to take. They came in to steal, you know. Today, most Dravidian speakers live in South India. There are islands of Dravidian-speaking populations out of South India. They are surrounded by Indo-Aryan people in Gujarat, Madhya Pradesh, Orissa, West Bengal, Bihar. You see, but you also find that Dravidian people are found in Pakistan, Afghanistan, Iran, and even Yugoslavia. Mm. Yes, Yugoslavia.
Mm. Mm. Mm.
Wow. But this is just to show how widespread Dravidian-speaking people were until the Indo-Aryans, until second frequency came in.
Mm-hmm.
And then second frequency exterminated most of them. As the Iranian Hurrian Mitanni nomads became more powerful, they set out to establish their own empire in India. These nomadic groups used painted grayware. Yes, we can chart the migration of these Indo-Aryan people from Iran into India by looking at the painted grayware. They entered South India from the Iranian plateau. They established sites in Baluchistan before they entered Gujarat. In Gujarat, these people began to fight the Dravidians. The Dravidian-speaking people used black and red ware. Some of the Dasas of the Vedic literature were Dravidians. See, we can tell in a sense the coming of the so-called Indo-Aryan people. The way we can tell the coming is that you can go into a town, and in a town, You have a layer of what's called burned ash. Okay, whenever the Indo-Aryans came into India, they would destroy the town where the black people lived. Most of the black people who lived in North India, they use red and black pottery. So you'll find that the top layer of soil, when archaeologists dig, they go through the layers of soil. There's a top layer, then you go to various layers underwards. And what you find is that below the top level where you find painted grayware, you'll find up under it red and blackware. So this shows in a sense that Indo-Aryan people had come into India and they replaced those black people. They usually burn their cities and towns down, you know. And so this is how we kind of look at it. On this map, we can see these Aryan invasions. You can see how they came into India, how they came and they began to spread out, and they began to attack as many states as they could, see? Because again, they use that whole idea of divide and rule.
Mm-hmm. Divide and conquer, sadly, yes.
Sadly, mm-hmm. Black people always want to believe I'm special.
Mm.
You know, my town is better than your town. Mm-hmm. So then Indo-Aryans will come in. Instead of the towns joining forces and fighting the Indo-Aryans who were unified, they just let second frequency come in and overwhelm them. Because mm-hmm. they didn't want to see mm-hmm. each other.
Mm-hmm. Create the divide and conquer, create infighting. And then once that happens, then they can come in and completely conquer and take over everything.
They can completely conquer. You find the same mm-hmm. thing in Chicago, Detroit,
yep.
Philadelphia.
Yeah.
That's my hood. I run this hood. Then you got a couple blocks. So I run this hood. And then they shoot each other for what? Over some damn petty ass drugs. I mean, nowadays you had to buy your own damn drugs. Back in the 90s, it was drug people. It was organized. Gangs had organized, in a sense, platforms to sell their drugs. Nowadays, if you sell marijuana, if you sell drugs, you're an independent businessman. And yet these gangs killing each other over some damn drugs or over something else, over the neighborhood. They don't even own the damn place they stay in.
Right. It's turf war, and they don't own the turf.
They don't even own the turf. But see, that's what happened with these Indo-Aryans. When they came into India, they went to this town, tore that fort down. Instead of the people in that fort going to the other fort and said, let's stick together. We could drive these people out. They were weaker than them.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But they were like a tight fist.
Mm-hmm.
And they unified. Mm-hmm. Then we talked about the Black Indians that lived in North America and how second frequency took them over. They took over the Black Indians in North America the same way. They wouldn't come together. You know, no matter what I say, I can go to these Black sites where you have Black modern Indians today, and all they talk about, I'm an Indian, I'm not African.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a Moor, I'm not African. Mm-hmm. I don't have nothing to do with those idols. Get the hell out of here.
Mm-hmm.
To the Indo-Aryan, like to second frequency today, all they see is a Black face.
That's right.
They don't care what tribe you say you belong to.
That's right. And they want you to end fight. They want you to end fight. They want you to put the Moors against the Hebrew Israelites and against the Muslims and against the Jews and against the Ados and against the B1. They want all of that because that creates a confusion that keeps you in slavery, that keeps you enslaved. And as a result, you never get out. You can never access or activate, I should say, your first frequency because you confuse heritage from ancestry.
Right. And that's very important. You shouldn't, you know, the second frequency, they stick together. Over in Europe, they might fight, but whenever they get around Black people,
they come together.
Mm-hmm. They become like the fist. Joshi, he's dated some of the PGW, a plain gray wear back to 1300 BC in the Punjab. This suggests that the Indo-Aryan speakers, they entered India two times. They entered India in one wave between 1300 BC. Then they came in another time at 1000 BC. When they came in 1000 BC, that's when they began to invade and destroy those cities. You know, most Indo-Aryans entered India between 1000 and 800 BC. This is what explains why almost all the dependable painted grayware dates cluster around 800 and 350 BC. So we find in a sense that by the second invasion, most of the people did not include the original Khaska and Hadi people. It was mainly, in a sense, Iranians. And that's why we see this relationship in the Indo-Aryan language. But we also find, again, a substratum, an underlying aspect of these Indo-Aryan languages is the Dravidian. The appearance of the painted grayware document the beginning of the Indo-Aryan invasion. As I said, today, those second frequency people and those Indo-Aryans, they try to deny that they invaded the country. You invaded the country.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You didn't begin civilization there, but they say they didn't. The Vedic hymns make it clear that the Aryans were illiterate, non-urban, non-maritime people, lacking in political complexity. They didn't even have a name for the horse. They didn't have a name for the chariot.
Mm.
They came in there culturalists. And yet they are able to sell people a myth today that they spread civilization around the world. Don't you believe it?
Mm.
Indo-Aryan speakers did not come into India peacefully. But Agveda supports the Aryan invasion theory. First, the Vedas talk about wars in North India between the Vedic and non-Vedic people. You see, they usually called, in a sense, they said much, when you read much of the literature, they talk about the Pura.
Mm-hmm.
Or the Tripura. The Pura, word Pura, or Tripura. Those were Vedic words for a walled city or a fort. You see?
Mm-hmm.
And they always say that their main god, Indra, he was the Puramdar. The Puramdar. And who was the Puramdar? Mm-hmm. He was a fort destroyer. See, they prayed to their God to help them destroy the forts. They prayed to their God to help them destroy these people. Ralph T. A. Griffin translated the Ayurveda in 1896. Book 2, hymn 11, 18, we read, "Thou hast disclosed the light to light the Arya on the lay, Levhan. O Indra, sancta disu. May we gain wealth, subduing with thou succor and the eyes, all our foes, that disuse." Disuse was another word for black, you see. And so they didn't come to India, they didn't come to India just to be there for a party. They came to India to find wealth. The Indo-Aryans came and they prayed to their God so they could become Puramdar, the fort destroyers, you see. So again, we find in these hymns,
my. Okay, so what are some of the non-Aryan civilizations of North India, Dr. Winters?
Okay, well, I did last week. We talked about the various Dravidians, but the Dravidians weren't the only black people in India. You also had what's called the Kshatriyas. The Kshatriyas, they lived in northern India, and many people, in a sense, try to say that the Kshatriyas were Indo-Aryans, but what do we see there? K-S-H. What does K-S-H mean? It means they were Kushites.
They were Kushites, yes. K-S-H, yes.
The Kshatriyas. Wow. But they'll try to tell you that these people were Aryans, but they weren't. And you know, for example, tradition has it that the monarchies of the Kshatriyas were concentrated in the Ganges Plain, where Ethiopians or Kushites who had intermarried with the Indians. As a result, the Indian republics of 600 to 321 BC, these were all founded by black tribes. You know, the Indo-Aryans, they didn't just overwhelm all the black people right away. It still took them years. And so one of the empires was the Kshatriyas. The Kshatriyas' primary interest was in agriculture. They did not recognize a single ownership of land as among the Aryans. All the land in the Kshatriya's Republic was acknowledged as being the property of the villagers. Remember, that's a key. That's a key to the Aryan, Indo-Aryans, and second frequency. Second frequency always want to believe in land ownership, individual land ownership. Look how many thousands of acres they gave George Washington and Thomas Jefferson and all that. You know, instead of just having a little land and sharing it with the people, they took it all for themselves. See? And that's the way all second frequency and Indo-Aryan people are. They're always looking for things for that one person. They want to share. But the Kshatriyas, the black people, the Kshatriyas in their dynasty, in their kingdom, everybody owned the land. Everybody had a right to land. See, that's not how second frequency think. Some of the Kshatriyas may have been descendants of the Nubian army. That tradition claim was led by King Shalarius, who conquered India all the way to the River Ganges. Remember, in a sense, I think somebody brought that up before about the Nubian army that went all the way to the River Ganges. You see? So see, it was always black people coming in and out of India, creating civilizations, raising civilizations. The victory of this king in India may explain the identification of the Aryans of Maluhites in the Ganges region. This results from the fact that the name Maluha was used to denote the Nubia Kush by the Sumerian Caddis. Remember last week we talked about Maluha, and Maluha was in a sense an ancient punt. And I was going to talk about the Australians next week. Yeah, we're still. I should.
What's going on? Something's changing.
Well, I might just talk about the various Ethiopian Semitic kingdoms in Southeast Asia. I don't know. I'll see.
But it'll ask the community, which one would they like? Which one would they like?
What do you want to hear? You want to hear about the Nagas next week, or you want to hear about the Australians? Put it in the chat.
Fantastic. The community will let you know.
Yeah. Okay.
Go ahead, Doc.
Then the second black empire was the Mauryans. The Mauryans, as the Kshatriyas before them, did not believe in the Vedic tradition. Like the Kshatriya, the Mauryans, they worship Buddhism. See, you had, in a sense, the Indo-Aryans who worship Hinduism, and then you had, in a sense, the black people who lived in India. They didn't worship Hinduism at that time. They mainly worshiped Buddhism. Their greatest king was Ashoka. He wrote in the Brahmi script, which was derived from earlier writing system used by blacks in both India and Africa. Brahmian and Tamilian scripts also show affinities to the Indus Valley writing. The Mauryans had good relations with the Abyssinians and the Dravidian kingdoms of Ashras and Shola. Under Ashoka's grandson, Chandragupta, almost all of India was unified. Ashoka established a federal republic. He also sent missionaries to spread Buddhism. We believe that Ashoka, this is believed to be, it's supposed to be a representation of Ashoka. And the thing that makes Ashoka very interesting is that Ashoka, he sent various Buddhist missionaries around the world, including Africa, including Egypt and Nubia, to try to reinvigorate Buddhism. After his death, weak rulers took control of India under these leaders. India broke up into numerous things. So in summary, various populations have become dominant in North India. These populations have practiced various religions, including Buddhism, Hinduism, and some were non-Aryan groups, all of them contributing to the unique history of India. In other words, in a sense, we talk about the Munda, we talk about the Veddoids, when we talk about the Indo-Aryans, we talk about the Kshatriyas, we talk about the Mauryans. What we see is that India was a unique place, but it was a place where black people have always been. And we also know that because of the Indo-Aryans, you have to be B1.
First frequency all day.
Because they definitely feel that they're going to be white. They're going to unify against you. Just like now in South India, some of the Tamil brothers, they want to be against the Telugu Dravidian speakers, against the Malayalam Dravidian speakers. See, they don't even know you're playing right into the hands of the Aryans. They want you to be divided. Because when you're divided, you allow them to take you over.
That's right.
See? That's right. Why they rule the damn country today. Because people are always so ready to fight each other. Why? Black people always feel they got to fight each other instead of trying to work towards a common goal, towards a common hope. See, in unity there's strength.
No doubt. And by the way, Dr. Winters, before I ask this last question, this next question, you open up a can of whoop ass. So between Australians and Nagas, it was a tie damn near. Everybody, I don't know if you could do both or just plan 1 week Nagas and the next one Australia. You got to do both. They want it all. I don't know if you can combine it.
I was going to do them, but I might just, since we're on this Indian thing, I'll probably do Naga.
Okay. All right. And then after that, we'll do the Australia. All right. So Akil Love, like, yay, he's got it, Naga. Oh, that's hilarious.
I just say niggas.
Right. Oh, what are we going to do with you? I don't know, but we love it. What does the history of India tell us about second frequency and third frequency? Come on now. That's the question. Come on, Doc. Tear it up.
Well, what it tells us is this.
You lost your PowerPoint.
What's that?
You lost your PowerPoint.
Oh, no, I don't have a PowerPoint for that.
Oh, okay. Yeah. That was the last. Okay, I got you.
So second,
go ahead, Doc.
It tells us that second frequency is always trying, in a sense, to make us stay in third frequency. It tells us, in a sense, that when we're third frequency, when we refuse to unite, and we refuse to be one, we're asking for the other group, second frequency, Indo-Aryan, Mongoloid. Mm-hmm. We're allowing them to be able to come in and take over. See, they took over Africa. Why? Because Africa was united, was disunited. Mm-hmm. Because of the fact that Africa was disunited, they were able, in a sense, to allow us to go off of, in a sense, our negativity. When they went to India, they wanted to find an army. So what did they do? They went among the people who was poor. See, black people always want to have a caste system. And in our caste system, we sometimes look down on other people. And because we sometimes look down on other people, the European has been able to go into country after country and find those people who we look down on. And they build them up as their military. They build them up as their warriors to fight you. And see, they don't be foreigners who usually come and fight you. It be the people that you neglected. See? O.J. Simpson said that when he was a kid, he used to have to get food out of the garbage cans and all that type of shit. Down in the South. Mm-hmm. I was always taught that we were loving people, we were kind people, but sometimes we have turned our back on each other.
Yes, we have. I know I went through it. Chicago just tormented my ass. I was like, wow. All right. Yeah. So now I'm living the middle finger in surround sound stereo. I mean, you just have to you have to understand what third frequency. When your original first frequency signal has been successfully interrupted, not killed, not extinguished, because you can't kill and extinguish AMA, black carbon, melanin, God, you can't kill it. You can't kill the signal, but you can interrupt that first frequency signal. And when you do, it creates a split, and it creates the third and fourth frequencies. And Carl Jung, if you're into Jungian understanding, he says, when something breaks off, what we don't understand breaks off and becomes more primitive. So when that signal, first frequency, is interrupted, and we now then have the have and the have-nots, right? So the haves is the third frequency, the have-nots is fourth frequency. And you see how we treat, how third frequency treats fourth frequency, how Negroes treat niggas. That has been going on and still is going on right now today. And that is how you divide and conquer a population. That is how you keep people enslaved without putting them in chains. That's how it's done.
You know, when I was teaching, you know, I had many of my colleagues and I loved them. You know, I liked a lot of them. They're very nice people. but mm-hmm. many other sisters, you know, they become afraid of Black boys. What are you afraid of? Mm-hmm. You grew up around mm-hmm. them. But because they mm-hmm. went away to college, mm-hmm. they came back, mm-hmm. and they became mm-hmm. afraid. Why are you afraid?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know why are you afraid? You know how Black mm-hmm. a lot of damn Black kids just be selling wolf tickets.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
See, mm-hmm. and they ain't gonna do nothing. But because of mm-hmm. the fact that they had lost that intuitiveness, they had lost that connection. And see, this is what second frequency will do to you. Second frequency, mm-hmm. if you don't really think outside of the box, second frequency will make you third frequency. They make you third frequency because you feel that if you go along to get along, everything gonna be all right. So the most
mm-hmm.
important thing is that what we get from India is that we see how in India, how all these civilizations rose, but they also fail. But they fail because mm-hmm. of the fact that we forgot to include everybody.
Mm-hmm.
You know, mm-hmm. it's just mm-hmm. like America today. America was the most blessed country on the planet Earth. God gave mm-hmm. gave the Europeans so much. Mm-hmm. But did he share mm-hmm. it? No. Even to this day. Mm-hmm. Even to this day, how they don't even want to share with each other.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And they definitely don't want to mm-hmm. share with first frequency.
Not at all. You know, it's funny you mentioned this.
So then they'd rather see the whole world go down.
Yes.
Rather than share yes. with each other.
Yes. Yeah. They don't care.
And it is amazing. But see, that can happen to you too if you're first frequency. Mm-hmm. And you forget mm-hmm. Ama, if you forget
right.
Mat, if you forget
right.
Aram that the Dravidians talked about, goodness, mm-hmm. kindness, mm-hmm. sharing.
See? Yes. Love this.
Goodness, love this. Kindness, sharing. Remember. Mm-hmm. Remember. You see, the more you always worry about pleasing them, your high blood pressure is going up. You know, mm-hmm. you're going to catch mm-hmm. all type of diseases. You're going to mm-hmm. have colds. Mm-hmm. You're always going to be trying to wonder why this, why that. No.
Mm-hmm.
What mm-hmm. does critical race theory teach you? Critical race theory teaches you that whiteness is property. Whiteness mm-hmm. has value. Whiteness mm-hmm. is money. Therefore, mm-hmm. you're not going to turn white. And unless they declare you an honorary white, they're not going to let you get that far.
Absolutely.
But that doesn't mean that you can't be successful. That doesn't mean you can't get more. That doesn't mean that you can be more prosperous. That doesn't mean.
They love it when you do that too. They love it when you get in the screen at them. I love that about you. I'm sorry. You're the only one. No, don't apologize. We love you for that. We love you for that. Listen, Doc, this is the thing I love about what you're bringing in this. And that is, you know, I've had, when I developed this theosophical framework based in social science, this four frequencies, I have had, you know, PhD, other PhDs and third frequency people just really come down hard on me. And I let them know, I said, you know what? This ain't for you. I didn't develop this for third frequency. I developed this for the people who have been left behind, that you shun and turn your back on and turn your nose up on. That's who I developed this for. This is for people who know and want to know that they're first frequency, but they have been divided and conquered. Their first frequency signal has been interrupted. And you have turned against your own people. So this ain't for you. And so you understand that you're always going to have this argument, family, when you come up against these kinds of folk. These third frequency people will, first of all, get upset when white people say, well, you know, Black people are all alike and they all look alike. And then they'll say, well, we're not monolithic. No, we're not monolithic. We're a multiverse. But then here's the problem. So then you go, so then you'll go and sell hats And then the third frequency Negro is going to come in and say, oh, you selling hats? Well, where are your shoes? Do you have some shoes? Well, no, we're selling hats. Well, then they're going to make you wrong for selling shoes. But you're saying, wait a minute, you're not a monolith. I sell shoes. Somebody, I sell hats. Somebody else sells shoes. You'll go to the shoe store and then you look for hats. They always are going to find a way to make you wrong and try to fit in. And this is where what Dr. Winters was talking about earlier, the Hebrew Israelites, the Moors, the heritage versus ancestry. This is what we're doing to ourselves. It's a level of arrested development from signal interruption. When you don't know who you are, you cling to an identity or an heritage that may or may not be even your own, but you want to be somebody, you want to matter. So you find the group where you matter, and then you fight for it. Now, in social psychology, this is fascinating. I just found this out. In social psychology, there's a concept we call groupthink. I'm doing this huge research on the consciousness of the people who climbed the state capitol January 6th last year. And they were talking about this concept of groupthink. Here's what happens in groupthink or heritage thinking, and like the Moors and the Yaka and the Hebrew. When you are in groupthink, the IQ of the group lowers by 10 to 12%. And that's for whites. It's lower for us. And why does that IQ lower? It lowers because the group is looking to win, not necessarily the truth. And so when you're looking to win, you're in second frequency mindset. You are in that property acquisition, person to object, axiological, shout out to Dr. Edwin Nichols, mindset. And so your IQ lowers, as well as your EQ, your emotional quotient. Dr. Winters has some papers. Thank you for that, by the way, Doc. You sent me a bunch of research on emotional quotient. You used to teach that. But that's what happens. So when you're in these groups, when you're in these groups, family, and you're making one wrong versus the other, them versus us, when you're starting to do that, either or thinking, your IQ lowers, your EQ lowers, because you're talking, you're trying to win as opposed to be free. And so what I've learned when I put these four frequencies together, I started looking at the characteristics, traits, and behaviors of first frequency. It's about being free. And in order to be free, it's for every one of us. Every one of us. I don't care if you're Moor. I don't care if you're Hebrew. I don't care if you're a Muslim. I don't care if you're Christian. I don't care what your identification or your label that you ascribe to yourself or assign to yourself or have been assigned to. I care that you know who you are, that your first frequency and your signal has been interrupted. They can't kill you, not spiritually. They can't kill the signal, because what was the law of thermodynamics? The first law, energy cannot be destroyed. It can only be changed, transformed, transmuted, transcended. So as a result of that, you can't kill first frequency. Otherwise, Dr. Winters wouldn't be able to do what he does. I wouldn't be able to do what I do. None of y'all would be able to do what you do, which is watching us do what we do. You wouldn't be able to find that resource. You wouldn't be able to find that understanding. So that's first frequency. You can't kill the signal, but you can interrupt the shit out of it. And that's what has happened to us. And I'm trying to scream it out to let everybody know, this is what it looks like. The moment you get into a debate, you're in that divide and conquer strategy. How can you, and Dr. Winters, I want you to speak to this if you could, my beloved. When you're in school, when you're in university, you're reading the same books. So perhaps at that point you can debate a particular topic or a particular chapter or a particular book or concept or theme, because that's what you're studying in university. But here we are, not necessarily in university, haven't read the same books, don't have the same parents, didn't go to the same schools, and we're sitting up arguing about who's right and who's wrong. How insane is that? I've got, Dr. Winters got 46 years plus of teaching. I've got, since I was 10 years old in metaphysics, so that's what, 45, 46 years, I'm 56 now, right? I've interviewed over 2,000 people. I've written 20 books. How can you debate with someone who's lived a particular life? I can't debate with Dr. Winters on the life that he's lived. We can go back and forth on a particular book or a particular piece of research that we're both reading. So then we can do a comparative analysis and say, well, I saw it this way, maybe, and what am I not seeing over here? That's logical debating. But you and I, so some of y'all, and I participated too, sit up and try to argue with somebody that lived a life we didn't live. That is insanity. That is insanity. And that's why you're divided and conquered. That's why you are trying to, this is what we're trying to teach in First Frequency, B1. This is why Dr. Winters is doing what he's doing. He's not doing it just necessarily for his health. He's also doing it because he loves his people and he loves being Black. But there's an understanding, and Dr. Winters, you said it best, there's a difference between ancestry, which is First Frequency, and heritage, which is the signal interruption where we get to fight about who we want to be and what label we want to ascribe to. Go ahead, Dr. Winters.
See, it's very important to understand is that even, okay, at university, we may discuss a book, but we're going to establish ahead of time parameters. We're going to establish how you should view the book. You see, that's why research shows that when people go to college, they become dumber. And the reason sense that people become dumber is because of the fact that the more you go to this class or that class, they teach you to think in a certain way. You see, I am a freak. I'm a freak of nature. I'm a freak. I should have went to college and got a BA, two masters, and a PhD, and still be B1.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
That's an impossibility.
Absolutely. 100%, Doc. 100%.
I'm a freak. And see,
that's right.
That's what happens to you. If you really want to be first frequency, you had to be a freak too. And you're a freak because of the fact you ain't bought in the third frequency. Thank you.
That's right.
See, that's what makes you a freak. And so then the thing is criteria. If you notice, to everybody listening to this, and if you go back and listen to my other shows, I don't tell you how to think. I tell you what happened. I give you a PDF. Right. That PDF, though people may think it's insignificant, that PDF allows you to read and internalize what it is that you've heard, and it allows you to see to determine, am I right or am I wrong? Should I accept this or should I accept that? This PDF is very important because the PDF gives you the receipts. Should allow you to move further. Some people out there have said that they take this to be a class, a weekly class. I don't have to write these PDFs, but I write these PDFs because I'll admit it was a brother. A couple of years ago, whenever I did movies, a lot of my Tamil brothers would say, "Dr. Winters, can you write something in English so I can understand what you said in the presentation?" So that's what we do. And that's what we're doing here. These PDFs.
And may I add to that, Dr. Winters? You talked when we were on the phone earlier. Here's something that the family needs to know. And that is the research that first of all, there is, because I know them all, not from a place of arrogance, but I've interviewed everybody. There is no human being, no scholar in our community that has put out 17 weeks of PDF content. That's a book, that's a thesis, that's a dissertation. There is no human being, no scholar alive or on the ancestral plane when they were here that produced more content than Dr. Clyde Winters in a PDF form. No one. No one, no one, no one. Number two, there is no scholar, and I'm speaking from personal experience, because I've got everybody's cell phone number. There is no scholar living today that is on these platforms, YouTubes or whatever platforms they use, that has produced more new research than Dr. Clyde Winters, because the PDFs that I'm reading, that he's producing, he is finding new evidence today, not from the 50 years ago or content that might have been written about somewhere back in the day and lost. No. We're talking about new research. He is acting as if he is back in university teaching at PhD level. Y'all don't really understand the significance of this cat. This dude is leveling the playing field. There is no, and I know this is, again, if we can try not to be tribal about this, because I know we love our scholars and I love them all too, right? But let's try to separate sometimes the scholar from the scholarship and look at the data. There is no human being living. There is no scholar living today that is teaching and doing great work in the community. Don't stop, but there is no Clyde Winters. He's one of a kind. There's nobody can touch this dude in terms of research. And the other dude that I could say is a badass researcher, but even and trying not to do a comparative analysis, that would be Dr. Oba the Shaka, right? Dr. O is that's a bad dude, right? Oba is the shit, but he does differently. He does, you know, like there's Dogon, integration trap, generation grab. Nobody does it. He's the only dude in the world that can do that. But if you look at the majority of scholars and scholarship, nobody does what Clyde Winters does. Nobody, he is dedicating infinitum, a PDF every damn week. And these PDFs, fam, y'all, some of y'all got them, are anywhere from 15, in some cases, 40 damn pages. That's a book every week with new cited research. Who the hell does that? I'm telling you, this is why we do what we do. And you better recognize who this elder and who this scholar is. What we also love, and that's two. The third thing that I love about this elder, by Baba Winters, is he doesn't mince words. I think it was Akil, shout out to Akil out there, who said something to the effect of, I think I know why Dr. Winters is not widely known, and it's because he doesn't mince words. Clyde ain't gonna come on here and bullshit you. Clyde gonna come on here. If you mention it, like some of y'all might mention a name of a scholar, Clyde's gonna check you. Clyde's gonna check the scholar. He ain't trying to harm nobody. He's just trying to tell you, look, these dudes are out here trying to, and Baba Kaba used to call them, he calls them, what is the term? YouTube scholars. These are new young people that are coming out trying to make a name for themselves, trying to get a following, because that's how they make their money. And I get it, right? As a result, they don't get they can't get that level of information and scholarship. You can't argue a 30-year-old, if I asked a 30-year-old or a 40-year-old, tell me what it was like in your 50s and 60s and 70s. Well, they can't answer that question. Why? They haven't lived it yet. So as a result, when we look at someone like Clyde Winters, I think he just turned 71, 72. When we look at a 50-year run of research and applied discipline that you have perfected, I, at 56, I can't argue with you. I can't argue that. I have to look and respect that elder. And that's what's missing now. We're not respecting our elders. I can't debate with Dr. Leonard Jeffries. I can't debate with Wade Nobles, Professor James Smalls. I can't debate with Kaba. I can't debate with Oba. I can't debate with Joy DeGruy. I can't debate with Edwin Nichols. Edwin Nichols is the oldest of all of our elders. He's 91. He just turned, I think in June, he'll be 92 this year. 50 years of the philosophical, 54 years of perfecting the philosophical aspects of cultural differences in axiology and dichotomous logic. Who the F are any of us to debate that level of elder and scholarship? This has to stop. And that's why there are certain people you see on this platform and certain people you do not. And I love all of my people. I love all of my family, but I understand what signal interruption does. I understand what signal interruption is doing to us in this, what we just had, my young son, I call him the prodigal son. We just had Amadeus Christ on here, who's a filmmaker, who, by the way, I'm getting ready to get Dr. Clyde Winters connected with Amadeus, because Amadeus needs some Clyde Winters in his life. We need to see a Clyde Winters, Amadeus Christ joint. Amadeus calls it the dusty hoteppers. This is what we're doing right now to ourselves, fam. We can't, you know, there's a reason why Dr. Winters is rocking with the shock. And I'm not being arrogant or narcissistic, but family, this shit works. I know it works. I've done the homework. I've done the discipline. I've been in the game. I didn't just show up here. I've been in the background interviewing every single brilliant freaking mind on earth, white, black, Asian, every one of them, and put all of that data together and develop this theosophical framework called the four frequencies. It was four histories, four frequencies, and four traumas. That's it. And when I found out and discovered that Dr. Winters knew about my work and then started putting his work in my work or referencing my work as a social science, my head just went, I was spinning. I was drinking at the time. I stopped drinking, but I was drinking at the time. I was like, this dude, what just happened here? You know, I say, hey, I had to stop drinking. But that's why we love you, Doc. And that's why I respect you, because you don't pull any BS, you don't pull any punches, and you just set the record straight. And this is not narcissism. This is just called tenure. This is someone who's paid dues, has receipts. And I'm sorry, I know some of you young folk that are in your 30s and your 40s, you want to equal that. But here's the thing. Here's what I want you to do. Try this, if you could. Rather than compete with your scholars or compete with your elders, compliment them. Compliment them. Reference their work. Give them the citation. Give them the acknowledgement. Dr. Jeffrey's pyramid analysis, process analysis, give them their glory. Give them the right to be the elder that they have paid a price prior to your arrival and my arrival on this earth. That's all I have to say. Go ahead, Dr. Winters.
You know, it's just like, you know, you're so right. When I used to teach educational psychology, you know, yeah, I taught about all the modern educators, Velasquez, you know, and things like that. But I had to go and teach about the Greeks.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I had to go back and teach about the people back in the day. Because mm-hmm. there's a mm-hmm. progression of knowledge. And see, the main thing is this, is that, you know, I want you. What I've found over the years is that many people want to do research. See, everybody that used to want to hear about Afrocentric history wanted to write Afrocentric history. So it was nobody in assist to want to support it because there's no money. So mm-hmm. one reason I write these PDFs is that I want to help those of you who want to move this history forward. Mm-hmm. See, you have that PDF, you have something in hand that you can run mm-hmm. to right away so you can move it forward. See,
right.
Instead of having to go through a whole book and then find the specific information on this page or that page of this book or that book mm-hmm. or 30 books, the PDF mm-hmm. puts it in a form where you know where to go and get it if you want to move mm-hmm. further. And see, that's the most important thing. I pride myself. When I was teaching research at Governor State University, I was the director of about 40 to 50 master's theses. I was the director.
Mm.
And then And the thing is, this is that I was the only one at that time that taught research methods. Then later they brought in another lady. I don't know how she teaches it. But when I was teaching research methods at Governor State, you was only supposed to teach your students how to write the first three chapters. But see, what I did is that in my class, even though my class was only one semester, I made them write an entire research paper and went through the entire process. See, and a lot of my students went on to get their PhDs. Because the fact is, this is it. I wanted them to know how to be the best. Not the second best.
The best.
The best.
That's right. You know, Ashe.
That's the whole problem.
Ashe.
In most research classes, these professors, they only teach you a little bit about statistics or a little bit about a little bit methodology, but they don't really teach you how to apply the statistics, how to take that methodology, how to read a research paper. But I did that. And I enjoy teaching. I enjoy teaching research, you see, because that's what I like. But the point is, this is that for those of you who want to take this further and have this more than just something you heard, you want to become a part of your bones, a part of your marrow. If you want to take it and translate it to your friends, to your families, to your children, you want to get that PDF, you see?
Absolutely.
It's becoming so terrible. It is so terrible out there now, in the sense that I taught. I went back. I need a little extra money, so I went back and I taught in upper grades during the pandemic. Now I need a little money to support the casino. Anyway,
for your little Vegas excursion.
Yeah, for my little casino excursion. What I found is that I did the online teaching. But I saw it wasn't reaching those kids. Kids need to be near somebody who they can ask a question. If you notice, every week, me or Reverend Matthews actually, what are your questions? Then he puts the questions out, because that's what scholarship is about. It's about questions.
Right.
You know, you got to make people be comfortable to see that they can ask questions. These kids, I know the past 2 years generation of eighth graders and in high school, they're a lost generation. They're not going to ever recover. They're not going to ever recover. I can tell you, because online teaching doesn't work. And I mean, I learned all type of ways to do it, all different types of ways to present it. But the kids still need to have somebody they can touch and talk to. Those rich people with money, they started little co-ops, or they started little projects where all the families came together and they hired a teacher to teach their kids. But you know, when you got the public schools, you know, you may as well be just teaching your own damn kid. If they get remote learning, and I look at Chicago and I look at all these teachers and these parents, I want my kid to have remote learning. Fool, your kid ain't learning.
Nothing. That's right.
But I know, I remember when I was, before I retired, because I remember when I was teaching in Chicago public schools. One day it was about 50 below. We had to come to work.
I remember those days.
Parents who brought their kids. 50 below, wind chill.
Wow.
Some parents just want their kids. They just want their kid to be in school so they can go to work. See, you pay a price later. When that kid doesn't have the confidence to go and learn a trade, or doesn't have the confidence to leave your home,
because
they don't feel they can go out and compete in the real world, then you're gonna face it. It's better to make those people, in a sense, do the work. Make teachers do the work. A lot of times teachers say, "Dr. Winters, you know, these parents are supposed to teach their kids. The parents are supposed to teach their kids shit."
Come on, Doc.
I said, my parents had a fourth grade education. Wow. My father, he could read better than any high school kid I ever taught. But they had a fourth grade education. When they sent me to school, my teachers had to teach me.
That's right.
You, Miss Well-to-Do. You, Miss Doolittle. You had to teach the damn kid. I can't teach them. I'll admit a lot of these kids, they don't want to be quiet. They don't want to cooperate. But the point is this. The point is this. Is that you can save your kids. You can at least give your kids a good idea about social studies, a good idea about where they came from by reading that PDF. The language is not, I didn't write in a highfalutin language. It's not in a technical language that you only find in research papers. It's in plain English.
Absolutely. Shout out to Tyrick. He says this scholarship will help us get our land, America, back. You're absolutely right, because this land, and actually all land, belongs to us. But it's about what Dr. Winters just told us. He says it's about the confidence. If you don't know shit, you can't do shit. If you don't know who you are, you don't have pride. If your pride is locked into a heritage that can change, that can shift, you are lost. You're not doing a damn thing. You don't have unity. You can't be B1. You can't be that first frequency self. So we have to understand what Dr. Winters has given us. And I do, and I appreciate you and love you to pieces. But I think looking at the community and how people are responding, they love you too, Doc. They get you. And they now know you real. Because we, you know, for some of us, some of the scholars and scholarship that we've seen on YouTube and Facebook and these different platforms, it's about ego. It ain't about love. And we are loving people, and we want to sense that love. Does this dude really, really give a damn about us, about me, you know? And that is, and so once we, well, I saw it long before you started the series, but when you did that piece on critical race theory, that was it. I was like, okay, this dude, this is the guy. And that's why I asked you to be our elder in our ministry in First Frequency of Oneness, because we knew that you love your people unconditionally, and you also love to teach, and you also still love to learn new things and new information. Nobody's doing this, bro. Nobody's doing this, fam. This is one of those moments in history. You know, we all have that first story of when we might, some of you, you know, I don't have those stories. Like when some of you told me how, when you met Dr. Clark, or you met Van Sertimore, you met Yakuman, when you, those first moments is that history that changed your life, that changed the direction of how you thought. It expanded your thinking in ways that nothing previously has done. What you're doing today, Dr. Winters, is doing that. You're changing lives and change and redirecting and taking us to a completely higher level than we've ever had before. Because I have to admit, even myself, I don't know about the community, but I got a little jaded, you know, because everybody was saying the same shit and the same stuff. And I have this process that I've used called shock, seeking higher omnipotent cosmic or conscious knowledge. So I'm looking for unequivocal, omnipotent, omniscient, spelled omniscience, but it's pronounced omniscient, omniscient scholarship. I'm looking for the highest of the high, the best of the best, as Dr. Clark would say. And I thought I had apexed with the levels of scholars and scholarship that I've had, and each one had their own thing. But who would challenge me to move to that next level of thinking? Dr. Winters, you have done that for me. And I assume you have done that for many of the people and the family, because it was over 200 people watching this program right now today. So I thank you. I love you. I honor you. I know you're going to ask me to do our prayer, affirmation. So I don't want to have to be put on the spot and reprimanded by Big Papa. But we're looking forward to next week that you're going to do the Naga. And I assume after that, we talk about the Australians, and or you might make a combination or whatever. But here's what I do know. Whatever you produce, it's going to be the ish. It's going to be the best of the best. It's going to be shock. It's going to seek highest levels of omnipotent, conscious, cosmic knowledge. That being said, family, let's take a moment and just honor this brother, honor this first frequency scholar, honor ourselves for being frequency specific to him and with him live right now today. And we will repeat, I am one with first frequency.
I am one with first frequency.
I am one with the first thought idea.
I am one with the first thought idea.
I am one with the firstborn people.
I am one with the firstborn people.
I am one with the only one.
I am one with the only one.
Ashe.
Ashe.
And so it is.
And so it is.
Thank you, Dr. Winter. Stick around with me in the green room as I sign off. Family, Uncle Job, Sineb, life, love, prosperity. We'll see you next time. Well, we'll see you in a couple of days. I got a surprise from Africa coming your way Saturday. This Dr. Elizabeth Wangari Gichimu is the truth. Got a little surprise for y'all. She's going to level the playing field from Kenya live Saturday. We'll see you then, family. Hotep community.